the Bay Area is the best area. So, all right. So I have the pleasure of being your moderator for this morning. And so we'll start up and we're going to talk a little bit about elbow problems. These are just my disclosures. I do some work in digital health and then some research with injectables. So neither of these should affect this talk. So you know, we don't give a lot of love to the elbow. I'm sure you see it from time to time in the office, but it's definitely not like the most common thing you probably see. So we're gonna spend a good half hour talking about these top common problems to give you an overview. We'll review the anatomy and then the diagnosis management, which you guys wanted to hear about. So the elbow is a ginglimus joint, so that actually means hinge in Latin. So it's a pretty complicated type joint where you've got this hinge that flexes, but then you have this rotation component where the radius kind of can swivel, and so the forearm can turn on this hinge. So it's actually a pretty special joint. The big components anatomically are going to be the humerus, the ulna, and then the radius, which rotates. And big kind of pieces of that are the trochlea, so the groove, and the coronoid, which is the tip of the olecranon on the kind of the palm side. It kind of tucks in there. That's where it goes there. Then on the back side, you've got the olecranon, so the pointy portion. And then you've got the radiocapitellar joint, which is like the capitellum with a smooth surface with the radius rotating on that. So when you think about the articulations, you got the radiocapitellar joint that allows it to supinate pronate. And then you got the ulnar humeral joint, so the hinge portion. And then the proximal radial ulnar joint. These two actually connect as well. So structure-wise, the elbow is unique because it's got bony stability as well as ligamentous stability. So when you're fully flexed or fully extended, your joint actually kind of locks up. So it's actually got a lot of bony stability, again, just for the hinge component. However, when you're in 20 to 120 degrees, you rely a lot more on the ligament structures. So we're going to talk about this in the throwing athlete. The ligaments on the inner portion or medial aspect of the elbow is the ulnar collateral ligament complex. So you've got three kind of major components: the anterior oblique, the posterior oblique, and then a transverse ligament here. And so, but they blend together, but the most important one being the anterior oblique ligament. And most important between 20 and 120 degrees of flexion. So you imagine throwing a ball, that's where that inner medial ulnar collateral ligament's gonna be very important. Now on the radial side, we talk about that as the one that allows you to supinate and pronate. You've got a whole complex, again, of ligaments, and they wrap all around that radial head. So, you know, this usually isn't as big of a deal for adults. Usually if you're gonna get this kind of injury, you're gonna probably have a bad fall and then basically dislocate your elbow or fracture your elbow. In kids, you can imagine when they're very flexible, this is the nursemaid elbow, right? So when they're really loose jointed, you know, they pick the kid up by the arm and then this thing just pops out. And then if you remember from pediatrics, you can just grab the thing, put some pressure on and then flex them fully, and then you might pop that elbow back in. And then you've got dynamic stabilizers, just like any other joint. The muscles do give some stability. You've got flexors and extensors. On the volar side, you've got your flexors, and they will kind of go from the hand and wrist all the way across into the epicondyles. And you've got your extensors on the backside, and then your flexors and pronators on the volar side. So just kind of things, because important history pieces when you have someone that comes in with an elbow problem. You want to know what their expectations are, because, like, you know, if they're going to be someone who does repetitive work, like a mechanic or something like that, that's very different than if they don't use their arm that much, because you can't really rest. For those of you who have chronic elbow problems, that's probably the big thing, right? You never really can rest your arm unless you're not going to work or something like that. So hand dominance, is this their dominant arm? Is this really going to affect them day to day? Can they really rest on that? And then you've got, if they're an athlete or something, maybe they are really a tennis player, and we're going to talk about tennis elbow. You know, sometimes you got to think and adjust what they're doing and think about the plan. What are they going to complain about in the elbow? They're going to complain of either pain, instability, or dysfunction. And every now and then you'll get the numbness, and we're going to go through how we look at all these symptoms and work through a differential diagnosis. Mechanical symptoms that would be concerning, maybe like some arthritis or some loose chondral injuries in the elbow. And then one big differentiating thing in the story that changes your differentials really is, this a traumatic problem or an atraumatic problem? So if you're working in the office, most of the time, obviously, we're probably seeing atraumatic problems, and it's going to be pretty easy to go through that differential. But if you fall on the ostrich hand and we're talking about trauma, then we're going to talk about the different fractures and dislocations you can have. So this is probably what happens most of the time, right? If somebody comes into your office, hey, you've got elbow pain, did anything happen to you? No, not really, it just came on gradually. You know, 90, 95% of the time, it's gonna be either lateral epicondylosis or medial epicondylosis, so tendon problems affecting the elbow. And so it's more common, almost like, depending on the study, almost 5-1 or 8-1 that you can see tennis elbow over a golfer's elbow. But those are, you can almost, you'll look amazing, because they just say that, you do the diagnosis, you got it right there. So let's talk about tennis elbow first. A little more common, just statistically, in males more than females, it's usually affecting the dominant arm. No wonder why that would be, because they're going to use it. But it's pretty common. Almost 1 out of 10 people have had tennis elbow. So, like, just a show of hands, how many people have had tennis elbow? Yeah. So maybe even like 10-15% here. And then the muscle that's most affected is extensor carpi radialis brevis. If you've got your boards coming up, that's the answer there. So the wrist extensors all come in, and then they come onto the lateral epicondyle. And so it's the extensors of the fingers, but mostly extensor carpi radialis brevis. And that's when we're going to kind of look at the physical exam. And I get the pleasure of doing the live demo, so I'm going to hold a lot of the physical exams until I can show you live. But that's where, like, you're testing the wrist extensors, and that exacerbates their pain. So when they're talking about what bothers them during the day, you can think about it. Like mousing on their computer, they got their arm extended, their wrist is extended. They're lifting things, like grabbing something off the seat next to them, or in the back seat, they're grabbing something. That's kind of when it bothers them. How about the milk jug? You ever get that one? They kind of grab it out of the fridge. That's a classic. And then finally, shaking hands, right? You got it extended, your kind of wrist is a bit extended, and your elbow's extended. Those are classics. For medial epicondylosis, we're going to talk about that, but that's more the wrist flexors than the pronators. So we call this golfer's elbow. So if you're a golfer, like, after you hit the ball, you usually flip your hands over as you finish the swing, and that's why golfers get it a lot. So a lot of times in the conservative treatment, and I'm going to go over the physical exam stuff, so you probably notice I skipped that. We're going to do that over the live demo. Passive stretching on the tendon, kind of for mild cases that I see in the office, that usually starts making them feel better within a couple of weeks. A lot of times people are a little apprehensive. They don't know what to do. They kind of don't use the arm at all, but then they got to go to work, and so they do use it, and it aggravates it. But, like, for example, if it was your extensors, just kind of passive wrist flexion and stretching it. And sometimes you got to rotate the hand a little bit to get the right angle to stretch it. You can kind of see it on yourself. Like you kind of twist the wrist in, you might get a better pull. And you got to keep the elbow extended, right? That's going to get the muscle on its maximal stretch. A lot of times people go like, oh yeah, I'm doing my PT exercise. You come in, hey, show me how you do them. And they're like, oh yeah, I stretch all the time. They're actually doing it with their elbow bent because they don't want to stretch the muscle so much. It hurts more. So you got to make sure they got it extended. And then how long to hold the stretch? A good 30 seconds. So like if you got a pearl to kind of start your patients on, just get them to do passive stretching a few times a day for 30 seconds. Like hopefully they could spare 2 minutes. And then as they start getting better, that's where you start introducing the strengthening exercises. So just a lightweight, dumbbells. Again, what's better, arm flexed or arm extended? Arm extended, right. You want to maximize the function of that elbow. So whether you use rubber bands or you use a lightweight, I tell people just grab a Coke can or something like that. Simple. And then don't forget the supination and pronation. So sometimes, you know, you get a picture of like in the textbooks of someone holding a hammer or something that's weighted, or if they're a tennis player, they can hold their racket and flip it over. That's another good muscle group to work on. Symptom-wise, ice, anti-inflammatories early on, that works great. Now, what about that elbow counterforce brace? You always get that. Patient always asks, hey, I see this people walking around at the gym. Study-wise, there really isn't any evidence that that works. The concept is maybe by squeezing the muscle, you won't be able to maximally contract the muscle so well. You know, practically having seen my patients that use it, even if it's a placebo effect, if they like it and they feel better, there's definitely no harm in doing it. And then if they're kind of conscientious enough to wear their brace all the time, they're probably taking better care of their elbows. So for some of those really nervous patients, if they think it's a good idea and they'll wear it, again, it's a reminder that they shouldn't use their arms so much. So I think there can be some peripheral benefits psychologically. And the reason why these things keep hanging around is this concept of tendinosis. We talked a little bit about it with the rotator cuff, but really what's happening at the tendon level is you're getting degeneration. So like, you know, all your patients call it tendinitis. That's acute inflammation, right? When your patient comes in 6 weeks, 12 weeks, 6 months later, this is not acute tendinitis anymore. That's why anti-inflammatories don't work great. You can't just rest them for 1 week and it's all gonna go away. If it's tendinosis, you really have degenerative changes within the muscle fibers themselves. So like this is normal alignment of collagen fibers. When you get micro tears and recurrent injury and healing over and over, you basically get scar tissue in this stuff. So the way I explain it to people is like tendons should have a nice stretch and they transmit the forces. It's like putting crazy glue inside of a rubber band. So when you start stretching it, there's almost like a stress riser, a very kind of vulnerable area that could get injured again. And like when you look at it under a microscope, there's no inflammatory cells. So would NSAIDs be really awesome for this? No, right? Or even you could put them on like a prednisone dose pack. It's not going to help them that much because it's not an acute inflammation here. It's a chronic degenerative problem. And so what you got to do is you really got to get them to kind of modify their activities, you know, like if they're a bowler like this guy, you know, baby, he should not be bowling. He's a professional though. So modifying activities, like so important, because like if they're the car mechanic, what are they gonna do? They can't be kind of, they gotta position better. They gotta make life easy. We'll let you guys show this again, this is so good. But ask them what they do, what really bothers them, because that practical advice, like people kind of can figure some things out, but surprisingly they don't really know it's the wrist extensor, but you guys do, you can tell them how not to do it. And then the exercises, getting to physical therapy, the importance of doing that stretching and strengthening program. Like if you guys don't recommend it, then you know it's hard for the person to buy in. And then so, again, we talked about NSAIDs, they just don't really improve the healing. So kind of one fact that does help some of your more chronic patients, I do explain that collagen takes almost 100 days to resynthesize and start healing. So How long do your patients usually rest after they get elbow pain? Couple of weeks, right? They always say that, hey, I just took it easy for a couple of weeks and then I went back and I played tennis and it still hurts. That's just kind of intuitively what most people end up doing. But if you look at like mild problems, that's going to go in a way in 2 to 4 weeks because that's acute tendinitis. But the other ones, they're going to take much longer with treatment. So you got to really enforce that this is going to take a while. Like one thing I sometimes say to people, it's like as long as you've had it there, it's probably going to take that long to get better. Like if it's more than a year, don't discourage them too much. But that's worked well for my patients. So let's talk about injections because, you know, that's certainly a big question and your patients will have talked to other people who got injected. And it really depends on how, you know, you look at these problems. You know, a lot of times if people are in a pretty fast clinical practice, you know, giving a steroid injection takes their pain away. They walk away happy and they don't see them for a little while. But, you know, that's not going to correct the collagen healing or that underlying scar tissue all the time. So that's where you get a lot of repetitive injections going on. But, you know, we can definitely teach you guys how to do this. It's pretty safe even if you do it blind, but a lot of people do them ultrasound guided now because it's a little more accurate. Let's look at the evidence first. Randomized control trial, steroids injection versus physical therapy. And injection group did work for 6 weeks. Like people felt really good after the injection, but after 6 weeks, they started a decrease in their improvement scores. Physical therapy was good, was better than just not doing anything. So sorry, it was randomized to physical therapy, steroid, or just nothing. But at 1 year, there's no difference, right? If people kind of allow that tendon to heal and you give enough time, everyone's going to do okay. Just to kind of bring that up again, a more recent study, another randomized controlled trial with steroid injection assessing at 1 month, and they saw that the tendon looked a little better because you imagine like the tendon gets a little inflamed. So you do a steroid injection, which is anti-inflammatory. It shrinks a little bit. But at 3 months, everybody's kind of doing the same. So like steroids are transient, but a useful adjunct. Definitely very helpful for people who have very severe pain. Like if you have someone who's gone, this is kind of my normal thing. I always try to not inject on the first one. I want to encourage them to do the stretching and strengthening exercises and modifying their activities. Now, of course, you get the one person who's like, oh yeah, I had that 2 years ago, I had the exact same thing, you know, this, and it worked really well, and like, you know, it's really severely painful right now, and I really just can't work and things. So there's unique situations where I'll do an injection early, but for the most part, I really want them to take good care of their elbows, so I try to discourage an initial injection. But if they can't lift, you've got a documented tear, just say like they come referred in, they got an MRI with a partial tear, you know, then it gets a little more complicated. Now for a straight up steroid injection, here's the lateral epicondyle, the fibers are inserting right there, that's where they're gonna hurt. It's like a button, I'll show this during the exam. And so that's where the scar tissue usually is, or that's where the tears are gonna occur. So what you can do is you can kind of go on an oblique approach, just aiming for that tendon. Now, when I was a student and a resident, like my learning was don't ever inject in the tendon. And then my first year in practice when I was solo and no one was looking over my shoulder, I'd do that. And every now and then I'd hit the tendon and I'd be like, oh man, I just injected the tendon. Or I touched the bone and they jumped a little bit. And then I was sweating and I was like calling them every day to make sure they're better. And those were the patients that did the best. And then like over time, I was just like, wow, this is really weird. And now we kind of know that actually poking the tendon can be very beneficial because it causes the area to bleed. And it's kind of causing trauma, but a new healing process right at that interface. So if you think about it, you cut your hand, you get a scar on your hand, right? Once it's finished healing, you might have an ugly scar. It's gonna take weeks to months for that scar to shrink down and look a little better, but very similar with tendon healing. It's gonna heal, it's gonna scar up, and then you've got a clump. And then that clump's gonna slowly remodel and stuff like that if it doesn't get re-injured. If you re-injure it, that's why you get that picture with that bad scar tissue going on. So the needle things, a lot of people are talking about needle tenotomy. You have to pass the needle through that tendon to break down the scar tissue. And physical therapists will talk about a lot. They like breaking down the scar tissue because they're trying to address and stimulate that area to remodel. So if you talk to some of the people who do a lot of these procedures, they don't just talk about a steroid injection, or we're going to get into PRP because I know a lot of people want to know about that, but they talk about needle tenotomy, where you actually pass your needle several times through the tendon to break down scar tissue and get the area to bleed. Now, if you imagine, that's probably counter to what you're always told about tendon injections, like don't inject in the tendon. Unless you do this a lot, I probably don't think tenotomy is what you want to get into a lot of practice doing, because this is where I probably would use an ultrasound now that I have the benefit of doing that. But you might hear about this as treatment options for when they go to see the specialists and stuff like that. But again, so for needle epicondyle, just to repeat that, I'll usually use a small gauge needle like a 25 or a 22, and then I'll kind of numb the area up, and then I'll kind of on an angle kind of along the muscle tendon, guide the needle in, poke the thing maybe 5 to 10 times, and then finish up with my steroid injection overlying. But I really caution them, because I've poked holes through it, you gotta baby it. It's kind of like if they acutely injured their wrist or their elbow and then they've got a rest. So this is kind of like a 12-week rehab afterwards, or protection afterwards. So they're not playing tennis within 12 weeks. If I got a pro tennis player and he wants to play in a month, I'm just doing a steroid injection around the tendon, but no holes. I'm giving him the pain relief, but not the other one. And we'll have some time for questions after this is all done. So going into the more advanced things, because I think you hear a lot about blood injections and then PRP. There's not a lot of hardcore randomized control evidence on a lot of things, but these are all done. You probably heard your patients get it. Like even things like acupuncture, very effective short term, but it's not a long term, there's not long term evidence for that. Ultrasound where you push steroid through the skin, a lot of physical therapists do that. It's not harmful, but it's not like got a huge amount of evidence that it always works. Autologous blood injections, people are just taking venous blood and kind of instead of steroid, they're doing kind of what I talked about and just injecting blood. Some people even do Botox or shockwave therapy. There's a new thing called 10X, if you've heard of that. That's a bit of a shockwave technology. And then finally, of course, even arthroscopic debridement without repair, that's kind of questionable. But what about platelet-rich plasma? And we're probably going to get into this a lot in the hot topics, as a lot of people ask us about this. But just a general, very quick overview, you just take the blood, you spin it down in a centrifuge, and it separates the plasma layer with the white blood cells and the red blood cells. And the plasma layer contains the platelets with your growth factors. So kind of, if you want to stimulate healing, kind of like what I was talking about, like poking holes for the tenotomy, you almost can amp the healing response by giving those platelets and growth factors. So this is probably one of the better studies that have been out there. Dr. Mishra is actually at Stanford, and he's been doing research on PRP for years. And so he did tennis elbow with some tendon needling. So that's a very important factor. What is it, the needling or is it the PRP? So that's one questionable thing. His successful outcome was defined as 25% improvement in pain. So at 12 weeks, the PRP injected patients were 55% and the other guys were 47%. So there wasn't a huge improvement short term, but at 24 weeks, it was 71% improvement versus 56%, having 25% improvement in their symptoms. So there weren't any major complications. So PRP is pretty safe if people do it well and don't do aggressive tenotomy or anything like that. But you guys can judge for yourself, is that clinically significant? And then you start thinking about how much this stuff costs. It's not being paid for by insurance right now. So I've heard things as high as $3,000 per injection in the Bay Area, and some people getting recommended that you have to come back for multiple injections. You know, so You know, the evidence is kind of speculative. There is positive randomized controlled trials, but also some that have no difference. And you can see that it's a little bit mixed up with tenotomy, which a lot of people do. So, you know, we can talk more in the hot topics about what we all think about PRP. Let's talk about some of the other elbow problems, like Little League's elbow. The throwing athlete, and you saw how, like, you know, at 20 to 120 degrees, that's where the elbow is quite vulnerable. That's where you get a lot of problems with throwing. So specifically for those of you who take care of kids, Little League elbow involves three things. It's stretching or injury to the ulnar collateral ligament. It's like loading on the radial head and then getting like damage to the capitellum, that articular surface. So you get compression forces here that wears down the joint and then stretching on the medial side. So you might remember that the growth plates come in a certain age, and I won't go through all of them at this point, but the capitellum kind of is that large surface here. And in the young athlete, it's not going to close for a little while, not until like they're into their teenage years. So it's a very vulnerable growth plate area. So if you have a young pitcher who's throwing, that area can get what we call osteochondritis desiccans, where that kind of bony fragment overlying the growth plate can get loose and then come off. This is maybe a little bit hard to see, but in your older athlete, this kid was around 14 years, but if you can see it ever so slightly, there's actually like almost what looks like a residual growth plate on this side, but it's closed on his non-throwing arm. And if he's tender there, that's where you have to start suspecting, you know, is this a medial apophysitis, which is inflammation at that growth plate. MRI can get useful in kind of figuring out, is this really a problem? Because it lights up a little bit. It's a little bit like Osgood-Schlatter's disease, but just at the medial epicondyle. So the treatment for that would be rest. A lot of these kind of ulnar collateral ligament, when it's not that bad, you're gonna rest these people. And then very important not to throw. But then I'm sure your parents are going to be like, well, can he play anything else? You'll be surprised that these kids don't have any pain with batting or just catching the ball. You know, throwing back to first is going to be hard. So you don't want the guy to be catcher and go back because the catcher throws a lot. But you can maybe get him back as he's starting to improve into like areas where he doesn't throw so much. Anti-inflammatories, ice, but that's a growth plate problem. So it might take that kid 6 to 12 weeks to settle down that inflammation at that growth plate. Now, what if it pops off? Sometimes these kids will throw so hard, they'll like just get a pop and they'll actually avulse the thing. And that gets a little more tricky. We end up non-operatively just immobilizing them in a posterior slab at 90 degrees, and then getting them in and transitioning them into a hinge brace. And again, just like the bone, it's gonna take 6 to 12 weeks, so you gotta protect them. And then, you know, with just conservative treatment and rest, most of them get better. Now, if it pops off a lot, more than 2 millimeters, that might affect how those tendons kind of work in his elbow long term. And you saw how sensitive tendons can be. So if it's more than 2 millimeters, or it's like got a lot of like instability over the ulnar collateral ligament, that's where the surgeons are going to maybe try to address this avulsion. So if you do run into it, I think it's probably worth just sending that off to the orthopedist to evaluate, just to see if anything else needs to be done. This is probably something that you won't see a lot of, especially these avulsions. Now, osteochondritis desiccans, that's kind of that area that we were talking about. They're throwing so much that they're loading this area, so they get hypertrophy of the radial head, so that gets like kind of almost overstimulated and grows more, but then you get growth plate issues on that side. Oftentimes, you might see this in both pitchers, but also gymnasts, if they're loading the elbow too much and they're starting at a young age. This is, again, one of those things that you probably want to send on to the surgeon if you run into it. But have that suspicion for the diagnosis, because if there's going to be some delay in getting them seen, just at least get the x-ray so you can make the diagnosis. So there's a lot of new rules if you do have young baseball players that you take care of or they're in your family. This is from USA Baseball Today for Little League Baseball. They say that pitchers under 14 shouldn't throw more than 75 pitches a game. They shouldn't really play in more league at a time, but you kind of often see them play at their school team and then they're in their traveling team. And then don't forget about all the warm-up pitches that they do before they actually get into the game, like in the bullpen or with their dad before the game. So you just got to watch it. You don't want them to throw 75 hard pitches, and they shouldn't be doing like the curveballs and sliders, things where they have to rotate their arm. So if you do have people that you have to counsel, those are the kind of the guidelines. Now, what about the older athlete? Again, that ulnar collateral ligament becomes a big thing. So if you're a Major League Baseball fan, you might have heard of the Tommy John surgery. For these ulnar collateral ligament injuries in the younger athletes, they usually do better, of course, because they've just got better healing potential. But we can take care of them conservatively with rest. But you hear about that Tommy John surgery in the news all the time. If they do get too lax and they're at that high of a level, just a little instability really can take a lot of mileage off their fastball or like just cause considerable pain for them over time. So the good thing is we've gotten really good at reconstructed. But this is where it gets a little tricky. Now you get a lot of high school athletes getting Tommy John surgery like in their high school ages. So it's going to be interesting. You're going to hear more about it because people being aggressive. But is this a problem of kids pitching too early? You know, an interesting fact for sports medicine is major league patients, very rare that they're ever pitchers when they're in high school. They're usually other positions, and they kind of transition to be a pitcher kind of in college. All right, let's talk about the differential for medial pain. I think the ulnar nerve is a big one that we'll wrap up with. That gives you numbness and tingling in the ulnar distribution, so the fourth and fifth fingers. They might be weak on their intrinsics. We're going to kind of talk about this in the exam. And there's three ways that the ulnar nerve gets kind of injured. It's running kind of right along that inside elbow. You either get traction to it. So if you imagine people that sleep with their elbow kind of bent in and now your finger kind of goes numb, so if you get that, that's what's going on. Maybe they've had some trauma to the elbow or they got hit there and got some scar tissue around the nerve so they could get compressed, kind of like a carpal tunnel type problem, call it cubital tunnel syndrome. And then you can also get friction. Some people who are hypermobile, the nerve rubs over the medial epicondyle. So you might actually notice it yourself. So we'll again talk about this in the exam. So the ways we do it, we're going to go over the maneuvers to figure that out. But the treatment's usually conservative. What you don't want people to do is get stuck in a flexed position too much. Or if they're subluxing, you don't want them to just keep aggravating it by doing repetitive flexion and extension. Surgery is pretty rare, but if you have someone with a subluxing nerve, they will kind of transpose it into the front. But that's in someone that just can't get better. But conservatively, like sometimes I'll put someone in a hinge elbow brace and lock them at 90 so they can't bend it. Or at least if they get a lot of problems at night and that's the big problem, I'll get them to make sure they have a pillow in their elbow so they can't bend. Just simple things. Don't let them get in that position too much. So we'll wrap up with some of the traumatic issues. Different things happen at different ages, and that's because there's growth plates. So when a kid falls on the outstretched hand, like in gymnastics, at a young age between 5 and 10, they're going to get a supracondylar fracture because the growth plate's above the epicondyles, and that's the weakest spot. If they're in the high school age, their growth plates are kind of closed, but when they land on it, they're usually going to dislocate the elbow. And then for adults, they often get more fractures. They can dislocate, but they can also kind of fracture a little more easily. So you see different patterns at different ages. And wrestling's a classic. Sorry, my video's not working, but this is one of those gruesome injuries where he lands and then basically the elbow bends backwards. But it's usually a hyperextension with valgus, so again, like that throwing motion, and then they're twisting on it. So it just basically torques the elbow. which is a hinge, and then breaks or dislocates the thing. And then it'll go often backwards, disrupting the ulnar collateral ligament, and then sometimes also disrupting the radial side. So we can treat it conservatively a lot of times, and then they're gonna, if you see it acutely, you might put them in a slab. A hinge brace is useful so you could at least get some range of motion, because the one thing about the elbow, it locks up really fast. So whereas other things you might keep in a sling for a little longer, the elbow you want moving within 2 to 3 weeks in most cases. Radial head fractures are the most common fracture you're gonna see. And sometimes you can't see it. It's often a hairline fracture that you can't see. So just when you think about it, they have pain on the lateral side of the elbow. And then when you get the x-ray, you have what we call the sail sign. There's a fat pad that kind of sits near the trochlea here. And when they have a big effusion, it gets pushed up. So you see this black triangle. That's called the sail sign. If you ever see it on an x-ray or you get it on a board question, that's what's going on. Just like we talked about for the avulsion fractures, if you have an intra-articular fracture with at least 2 millimeters step off, that's where they're really gonna consider operating on that, because that'll lead to arthritis if you leave that in a joint that moves so much. Other things that can happen after these elbow problems, a lot of scar tissue. You run into these patients, they fell off their bike when they were young, they can't extend their elbow all the way. So very sensitive joint. They also get a lot of heterotopic ossification, so bone likes to form into the muscles, and that's another reason that causes chronic pain or loss of motion. So get people on therapy early, and don't sling, especially older patients, for more than 2 to 3 weeks. So for the elbow, I think the take-home points, you know, get a really good history. Is this traumatic versus atraumatic? And then think about the age of the problem, because it presents with different things. And then think about the patient's expectations and functional demands, because you got to craft a good thing, because people can't always rest the elbow so well. All right.